about, let's see, what's the date today? I have about 3 weeks left of my term. So we're kind of coming to the end of a wonderful year, and it's been great. And I want to thank Contra Costa County Bar Association and the Women's Section for inviting us and being creative enough to think about putting together an event like this. And this is the first one. This is what we would probably consider our pilot program today. And I think it's going to grow from here, and it's going to be really wonderful. So thank you for having us. My portion of the program is going to address elimination of bias, more specifically elimination of gender bias. When we get to Neda, my colleague's section, we're going to go into the substantive format and content regarding eDiscovery. So hopefully we'll be able to meet your needs for MCLE credits, but also you'll be able to learn quite a bit about both gender bias issues and also eDiscovery. So with that, we'll get started. So CWL, a lot of people in the state know about CWL. We have a lot of influence. There's name recognition. And of course, we're the only statewide bar association for women lawyers. But we often get the question from our regional affiliates about, what do you guys do that's different from our local section? And so I think some of these things will address that. And still, and I think we'll also address the fact that in this day and age, we still need an association for women lawyers. And our hope is that someday there won't need to be a separate bar association for women lawyers. It'll be all together, everyone equal. But until that time, and you'll see what I'm getting at as to the need, we still have a need for these type of associations. So with that, we can go to our first slide. This is actually, gives you a little bit of information about our background. This is actually our 40th anniversary this year. We were founded in 1974. So this is about 2 years after we were founded, and we have some clips here that we found in our archives that we included in our PowerPoint. This was our second board of governors. They represented 9 districts. Currently, we have district governors that sit on our board from the various districts as well, District 1 through 9. And 9, for instance, is San Diego. District 4 is San Francisco, Alameda County, and what have you. So this is just a really interesting slide because it shows you, for instance, election recap. We have this little news blurb that says, also, for the first time in the 126-year history of California, the all-male state senate was being invaded by a woman. Roseanne Weish from Dinuba won the 50th district senatorial seat. Well, I'm sure that verbiage is not lost on anyone. It's a sad statement. The other thing that's interesting about this is that we found this clipping, equal work deserves equal pay. And you know, it's interesting, about, I'd say 6 to 8 weeks ago, there was the exact same verbiage on some Facebook pages out there. And so it tells you that the more things change, the more things stay the same. Of course, you go from a newspaper to now social media, but we're still striving for the same things, unfortunately, 40 years later. So again, here's this, it basically says in 1973, demonstration sign that could be today's Facebook rounds, but it actually, that's the sad part, it's not a cook. Okay, so where are they now? These are some of our pioneers and founders, and these women were really the people who spearheaded the efforts. We have a Founding Mothers video that's available to anyone who's interested, and that we show every once in a while. Natasha, I think, has seen it. And it basically talks about, back in 1973, at a state bar convention, a group of women got together in a ladies' bathroom and decided, you know what? We're here, nobody's acknowledging us, and we need to have our own organization. This was at a state bar conference in San Diego, I think. And there were certain instances that are recounted by Lynn Shane, for instance, who was one of our founders, where they would stand up and want to say something on behalf of women lawyers, and there would be derisive laughter toward the women. And so, long story short, in 1973 and then in 1974, where it really sort of gave critical mass, a group of women got together, a very, very small group of women, probably no more than the group we have here, maybe less, and decided to start California Women Lawyers. And the rest is, as they say, history. Some of the founders and pioneers have been named here. Louise Rennie, she's a former San Francisco city attorney and now has a public interest litigation and other financial abuse practice group. We have Judith McKelvey, Dean of Columbia University School of Law, and she's the second woman in the country to be dean of the School of Law. I'm not going to go through all of that, but Herman L.K., Unicole Hall, Faye Stender, of course, political prison rights activist, champion of the Black Power movement. Every year at our annual dinner, California Women Lawyers gives the annual Faye Stender Award to a feminist woman lawyer who has been basically championing those who are minority and what have you. Faye was involved, I believe, with the Black Panthers, and she did a lot of work for civil rights and prisoners' rights. Ultimately, unfortunately, she was shot by a former member of the Black Panthers. And I think about a year later, Natasha, you probably know the story, about a year later, she took her own life because she couldn't live with the pain. She died really, truly believing in equal rights and that everyone, women, minorities, should have, that their civil rights should be respected and should have equal access to justice. And of course, we lost her. But she was one of our founders, and she was a really amazing woman. Arlene Coleman Schwimmer, she's the, one of our founders as well, one of the pioneers, and she's fun to talk about because she's David Schwimmer's mom.
Oh,
and friends, yeah. So we always like to talk about her. She's a very successful family law attorney in Southern California, and he is actually often been quoted in the press as talking about how strong his mother is and how much he looks up to her. So very good PR for women lawyers out there. And of course, the list goes on. Really amazing women. The rest are listed in the packet. So why CWL? Well, CWL works to advance women. And if you look at the figures, and they're also in the packet, it shows, generally speaking, and I could go through this in detail with you, but it really shows that we haven't made much progress since 1993. The numbers are not that much better. And everyone knows how to read the pie chart here, but I'll go through it. In 1993, the number of associates, so the ratio was 38.99% women, 8.36% minorities. And in 1993, partners were 12.27% were women, 2.59% were minorities.
Can you tell us what the colors represent? Because it's hard to read.
Sure. The blue is women, the red is minorities, and the green is other. So I like to call other old white men. That's basically, white males. That's basically how we break it down. If you fast forward to 2011, and we have more recent figures, but they're not that different, actually, unfortunately, from 2011. We've made some progress. From 38.99%, we've gone up to 43.35% in associates. 19%, which is, I think, a much bigger stride. 19.9% in minorities. And then in partners, we have grown from 12.27% women partners to 19.54%. That's not very much. That's a pretty woeful ratio. And then 6.56% of partners are minorities. Again, not too high, not too great. I know it's a little bit difficult to see the pie chart, so I'm going to skip that and you can look at it. Not the pie chart, the graph, you can look at it in the packet. But essentially, what we're looking at is women as a percent of. I should look at this.
JJD
enrollment. Sorry. 2002 to 2008. Well, what this reflects basically is that enrollment has gone up. And one of the things that CWL is very concerned about right now is that we think that we've achieved a level of equality in the pipeline. So the JD numbers, the law school numbers, the law school enrollment numbers all look very good. What's troubling is that you see this very large percentage of attrition after law school. And so what happens? And we're looking at the reasons why it's happening. When women lawyers are opting out of practicing law or moving from litigation practices to transactional practices or taking themselves off partnership tracks. We want to look at it when it's going on. So again, the enrollment numbers look wonderful and we have made great strides there, but it's still not addressing the long-term issues facing women lawyers. Women in private practice, so we're looking at, again, the percentages, and 19.9% of partners, 15% are equity partners, and 4% are partners in the 200 largest law firms. And of those, only 3 are managing partners. So what this reflects is very interesting because you can see that as compensation goes up, power goes up, influence goes up within an organization. So you go from partners being 9.9%, which is fine. You know, when you look, you see that we've made some strides here. If you really look at the underlying progress, it's not significantly better because, as you can see, you go from partners 19.9%, equity partners dips down to 15%, and then partners in large firms dips down tremendously. I mean, it's a cliff, down to 4%. And then beyond that, there are only 3 managing partners in the large law firms. But you can see juxtaposed against, well, geez, everything, this is the thing I get from young lawyers and law students all the time. But it's equal, it looks fine. If you look at the 2 last bars, that's not bad, right? It's about 50-50. You look long term, which is what I was just talking about a minute ago, and we've got an issue here.
What do you think is the reason that there's this attrition?
One of the biggest issues that we've heard from around the state is that women lawyers feel like they aren't given the opportunity to advance in the same way as men are within their firms when it starts coming to the point of getting origination credit. Compensation is an issue. There's a lot of demoralization, a lot of polarization after returning from attorney. Not getting great cases. Sure. But Natasha just asked a question about, I know, I can hear it too. I think it's just blasting air up here.
There's some fan.
Yeah, there's something. I'll try to talk a little bit louder. But some of the primary reasons for this attrition tends to be, I think, an overall general demoralization. Thank you. That's better. And how that's manifested is through polarization after return from maternity leave, not being given origination credit in the same way that their male counterparts are, not being allowed to go to pitch meetings, not having as much client contact, and frankly, the thing that I haven't talked about so far is that women lawyers are still getting paid 77 cents on the dollar compared to men. And it's happening a lot in the small to mid-sized firms because they don't publish their salaries and compensation. And so it's kind of a well-kept secret still, but it's happening. And so that's a big problem. And so there's a lot of self sort of opting out because when considering the other options, it's not so great for women lawyers. There are a lot of sacrifices that need to be made. I've talked to a lot of people who say that they feel like they've had to work twice as hard and sustain that, even when they make partner and they're expected to bring in more business and still bill hours, whereas their counterparts are expected to bring in business, but maybe they can ratchet back a little bit on billing hours, things of that nature. So there's a lot of that. And the fact is that we haven't quite caught up as a society to the sort of, I think, demands that are made on us in our personal lives against our work lives. And there isn't an acknowledgement that there needs to be some structure and some flexibility, particularly for people who, and I'm not just talking about maternity leave, but people who have ill parents and they're the only children. There are a lot of commitments and responsibilities that I think women have outside the home, outside of work, that just, there's many firms are, they don't want to hear. So what do? You have to make some very difficult decisions. So, okay, so let's go on. Diversity on the bench. So we work closely with the governor's office to promote diversity on the judicial bench and also endorse judges nationwide. And we'll talk about that a little bit later, but CWL really concerns itself a great deal with judicial equality and fair representation of the population. And we keep a very close eye every year when there's an announcement of what the percentages are, the demographics are on the bench. We take a very close look at that. In this case here, we see that for the California judiciary, for state court, 29.9% are women, 70% are men. And for federal, it's a little bit better, 32.5%, 67.5% male, men. So the numbers are not as depressing for the bench right now, particularly in the federal judiciary for women, as opposed to, you know, the scenario we looked at with respect to equity partners and law firms. We're doing a much better job, but this is not, I mean, this speaks for itself, that this is still not anywhere close to where it should be. So we're working on that, and I'll talk to you about that in a little bit. Okay. So CWL is very unique in the sense that we are an advocacy organization. We're not a local section, if you will. That we find that a lot of the local sections focus primarily on MCLEs and networking, which is really important. But what we like to provide in terms of the sort of statewide picture is our work in advocacy and our legislative efforts and lobbying efforts. That is, Natasha, for instance, the question that we get sometimes at board meetings from local affiliates is, what's the difference in some of the things that CWL does versus our local affiliates? Like, you know, I'll throw one out, like Women Lawyers Association of Los Angeles, which is prolifically, you know, writing things and doing MCLEs and having networking events. But we have yet to find a local affiliate women's section in the state that does the kind of legislative work that we do and the kind of work we do on the judicial front.
Yeah, and just recently we did a Twitter storm of not my boss's business.
Yeah.
And, you know, we go out there and educate the public and try to do as much as we can to get the word out on these legislative bills that are coming up, and also write amicus briefs.
We do that too.
And
yeah.
So there's a lot that goes on behind the scenes.
there really is, and it's a classic example of a larger organization that has the firepower, that has the united voice. We represent all women lawyers in California. And so people pay attention when there's a letter that comes from us.
Yeah.
I get a response from the governor's office or from a senator or from some other legislator within days.
Right.
So we have a lot of firepower, but because of that, we're also very selective about what we get behind. So here, we support legislation that furthers our mission to advance women in the law and in society. Including legislation to eliminate human trafficking and sex crimes against minors, legislation that carries out the intent of teen parents in the Foster Care Act, legislation that gives the Department of Insurance and Managed Health Care the authority to disapprove requests for excessive premium increases, legislation addressing rape loophole for people due to intimate relationship. This was a really tough one, and we went through a lot of work, and we did a lot of amicus work on this as well. Our reader. And you can see we did a whole lot of other things with respect. respect to the Violence Against Women Act, transparency in judicial selection, family justice centers, shackling of pregnant women in prison. And you can see, if we just limited our efforts to legislative work that involved women lawyers, we wouldn't have our hands in all of this, but we do. And it really furthers our mission to protect, promote, advance women, minorities, and children in particular. So a lot of really interesting work. We have a new program that we're launching in October that I'm really proud of. It's called, we're going to trademark it, so don't use it. You've been warned. It's called Elect to Run. It's our first one. It's going to be at the National Feminist Majority Foundation down in LA in October. I believe it's October 18th. It's going to be on our website soon. And we're basically going to be putting on a program for women lawyers and women in general on how to basically demystify the process of running for our public office. The numbers for legislators right now that are women is just really horrible. And so that sort of comes under our legislative efforts umbrella. So we're really excited about that. Really interesting work. Okay, we are a national voice. We have very strong alliances and work, again, on a statewide and national level with organizations such as the National Conference of Women's Bar Associations. That's a really wonderful organization that basically comes together at a summit every year with representatives from each state. So, for instance, the New York State Women's Law Association, Bar Association. We also work with the National Association of Women Judges, NAJ, and we also work with the National Association of Women Lawyers. So really strong relationships. We exchange a lot of ideas. We support each other. We co-sponsor the events, and there's a lot of strength in our relationships. So really interesting work and really great organizations. We're also pretty selective about who we align ourselves with. We get a lot of requests from a lot of different organizations, and we have to be pretty careful. We look at their missions very carefully, we look at the work that they've done. Sometimes we sort of track what they're doing before we make any commitments to work with particular organizations. You can imagine the problem a lot out there. Okay, amicus opportunities. That's what Natasha was talking about. We write or join amicus briefs in cases that affect women's rights, including Hollingsworth v. Perry. Many of you know that case, of course. Those are the marriage equality. That's a marriage equality case. People versus Beltran. This is a challenging overturned murder conviction and domestic violence case. There are many more. Bolliere versus Sweetwater, joining National Women's Law Center and Equal Treatment in Athletics cases. We get, again, this is along the lines of what I was telling you earlier. We get a lot of requests to join amicus briefs that are out there, and we're very selective about what we will associate with. Because I think a lot of people want the CWL, the California Women Lawyers, stamp on the pleadings sheet. We just, we're very, very careful. We have an amicus committee that vets these cases very carefully. And at least two of the people on our committee are usually, it's a revolving committee. It changes every year in terms of the chair and the members. But it's usually at least two appellate lawyers on that committee from our board. So really, really well populated. So this is something that we talked about a little bit earlier and touched on. This is another trademarked program. This program that we have has won national awards, and we get calls all the time from various state bar associations that want to try to replicate it. It's called So You Want to Be a Judge. So we put on this this program at least once a year, and we try to alternate between Northern and Southern California. And this year we held it at McGeorge, and it was up here in Northern California. And it's basically a program to demystify the judicial application process. This was in response to a lot of, we were looking at the women judges ratios, and this is in response to a lot of women lawyers saying, okay, I'm trying to manage my household, I'm trying to manage my practice, and I just pulled up the Jenny Commission application on what's required, the governor's application, and it's 20 pages. I have to find a list of every opposing counsel I ever had in my entire career, and it's too much. I can't do it. And on top of that, I don't even know if I'll get it. So we created this program in response to those fears and concerns, and we help connect members with judicial mentors. We work to educate our members interested in becoming a member of the judiciary. And this program that we put on once a year is really wonderful. It's one of the few events that the appointment secretary for the governor's office will attend and speak at, not to mention the head of the Jenny Commission. So every year, the Jenny Commission is the Judicial Nominations Evaluations Commission. And the two, I would say, two of the most influential people who would be possibly looking at someone's application would be, right now the appointment secretary is Joshua Gordon, the pro-man and the head of the Jenny Commission. This is a great program. These folks come, they do a panel, and then there's a breakout where there's little workshops with various judges who will sit and talk with potential applicants in a more intimate setting. And it's about 3 hours long, and we get so many wonderful responses from people. We have helped a lot of people get on the bench. So that brings me to our judicial evaluations process, and I'll get to that in a second. We really try to spread the word that we do evaluations for judicial applicants. And we're one of the few, again, state organizations that has a very robust evaluations process. And one of the things, the last So You Want to Be a Judge program that we put on with the appointment secretary there representing the governor, somebody stood up and asked, and I think it was a room of like maybe 70, 80 people, somebody got up and asked, how do you set yourself apart? What do you do? What are the things that you look at? And he said, get a CWL endorsement. Get an evaluation done by CWL. That's very powerful stuff. So I don't think he'd go out on a limb and say that about most organizations. And one of the things he did say is, you know, we look at various organizations' endorsement letters. They're nice, but we just know they haven't gone through that evaluation process the way the CWL puts people through evaluation processes. And they don't. CWL looks at things in a much more profound, nuanced way, in addition to all the different things that they do. So I thought that was really encouraging. If you know anyone who is interested in joining the bench at some point, whether it's now or 5, 10 years from now, they should become a member of CWL. They should get involved with CWL, and they should, even if they're not that involved with the organization, they should really consider going to these programs that CWL puts on. They're very powerful. One other footnote to all that is that one of the things we did recently for this judicial workshop that we put on is that the immediate past chair of the Jenny Commission and the current chair of the Jenny Commission, who conduct the interviews of judicial applicants, they did a mock interview for people, which was so cool because they basically said, because everybody knows that the interview is really important, and they basically did all the things, what not to do and what to do, and everybody thinks they know how to give a good interview at this point in their career, and some of the stuff was not instinctual, it was not intuitive that you shouldn't do. It was really interesting. Really fascinating stuff. So, and it's from the horse's mouth. They've all been there through many judicial application interviews. So, very cool stuff. Okay, awards and scholarships. We present awards and scholarships every year. And again, we're pretty hard graders on these, but I think rightfully so. They are sought after. We present the Roseburg Memorial Award to the outstanding jurist in Northern California. We do a similar one under Joe Dempsey Klein's name for a Southern California jurist. And then we do the Judith Soley Award, a citizen, and the Face Gender Award, we don't do Judith solely every year. We only do it now and again. But face centers are standing annual award at our annual dinner. And then Women of Achievement, we usually give a number of awards to Women of Achievements at our annual dinner. As you can see, they're all lined up from last year's. We try to sort of keep things even and fair by giving a jurist award in Northern California and then Southern California. And every year, we get a number of nominations for various jurists from each region. And it's a tough decision. I mean, Natasha, you've been on the board where we have the meetings where we're vetting the nominations.
Right.
And these are like amazing people, you know. They've been on the bench for 30 years. They've done all these amazing things. But then there's another one. There's another nomination for right. which is really wonderful. So we have the privilege and the honor of being able to give these awards. This year at our annual dinner, which is on September 11th in San Diego, we are giving our first ever Lifetime Achievement Award to Justice Joyce Kennard, who has retired from the Supreme Court. She's an amazing person with an amazing story. And our Face Center Award is going to Lynn Shank, who is one of the founders of California Women Lawyers.
Oh, and Judge Becton won the Rose Byrd Award a few years ago.
That's right. Yeah. And we had the reception here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And she's our judicial liaison for CWL.
She is.
So Contra Costa is really strong in CWL, for sure.
Very much so. And Judge Becton, I think this is her third year now as a liaison. And she's so gracious, and she really believes in CWL. And very, very big advocate. She comes to almost all of our events that she can. And she's a very strong force. A lovely person, so we're very happy to have her in our fold, in our midst. Okay, CLE and networking. We host an annual conference every year to present cutting edge programs specifically directed to the advancement of women in the law. This year, our annual conference, again, we try to alternate between Northern and Southern California because we want to keep it as fair as we can. Although we do have people traveling from all over the state to go to a lot of our events, so it just depends on the opportunity. This year, our annual conference was in LA, and we put on 10 different programs in one day. It was really amazing, with some really interesting people as speakers. Our annual dinner, as I've talked about, is attended by over 500 statewide attorneys each year. We're currently, last I checked, we're at 600 for this dinner. We have literally run out of sponsorship page room and seats. I think we're technically sold out, but I think they'll add more tables if we need to. Really exciting stuff. And of course, we get a lot of, I think, good publicity in the Daily Journal and the Reporter. And this particular article we covered at annual dinner from last year. This is a little bit of the tip of the iceberg for California Women Lawyers. I could go into a lot of details about what we do. We are a very engaged organization. We have a working board that really rolls up its sleeves. It's a very large board. We have about 35 to 38 board members. So, I'm corralling everybody at every meeting, but we have these really wonderful meetings where we get to exchange ideas and work with really neat people, and it's just such a boost. And I'm very proud to be part of this organization. So, yeah, and I think we have our meetings. We have a meeting almost every other month, and they're throughout the state. So we try to take turns. We go to San Diego, we go to Sacramento. We're all over the state. But again, it's a really wonderful organization. Recommend that anyone join it. And we get these nice emails from people every once in a while. It'll be a male lawyer, and he'll say, "Can I come to your So You Want to Be a Judge program, or can I join?" And we're like, "Of course." You know, I mean, we're very inclusive, and the more the merrier. And all we ask is that the person be supportive of the advancement of women and the promotion of women and believe in equality. So if you have that, you're good to go. So please spread the word about California Women Lawyers. We're growing every day, and it's really wonderful. So before I turn it over to Neda, does anybody have any questions for me about California Women Lawyers? Okay, I've answered it all. So with that, again, thank you to Natasha, thank you to Marta, thank you to Erica, thank you everybody for having us here. And now we're going to move on to eDiscovery. Thank you.
So let me introduce Neda Shakoori. She's also with McManis Faulkner. She established her firm's eDiscovery initiative. Sorry? Yeah, that's great. And then she provides management, consulting, and oversight on all eDiscovery processes. So I'll let you introduce yourself more.
So hello everyone. Thank you again for being here. I will try and keep this somewhat short so as not to bore everyone, but you will find all of these slides within the materials that have been handed out. And if you have any questions, all of our contact information is at the end of the slide packet. We're more than willing and happy to answer any questions that you have. So one of the important things to know about eDiscovery is a lot of people have kind of a fear around eDiscovery, and they think that, oh, eDiscovery is just something that's for the big firms, and that's not necessarily true. Small solo practitioners, medium-sized firms, you have all the tools that you need to, I guess, play with big dogs and the big firms with eDiscovery. It's not something that you should fear. It's manageable if you have the right tools and you effectuate the best practices. So that's what we're going to be talking about today, are the best practices for the everyday case. And given the constant rise in the amount of electronically stored information, which is ESI, we as attorneys have a duty to understand how to manage the ESI. So what is causing the rise in ESI? Email, as we all know, is being used on a daily basis. We send hundreds of emails per day, if that, sometimes thousands if it's a large organization. Electronic documents as well. I don't know the last time that I submitted something via a handwritten paper document. We're creating electronic documents, Word documents, PowerPoint, etc. Social networking, as we all know, Facebook, Twitter, the list goes on and on and on every day. There are tons of new social networking sites that are going up, and those all increase electronically stored information. Text messaging is another big one. I don't know if any of you are family law practitioners, but text messaging often comes into play a lot with divorce cases. The list goes on, digital pictures and videos, transaction records, cell phone GPS signals, etc. So, how does one address eDiscovery in ESI? I don't know if anyone here has heard of the Electronic Discovery Reference Model, also known as EDRM. I have a link to the website at the end of your packet. I highly encourage everyone to go to the website. It's a really, really good resource for a wide array of things relating to eDiscovery. The EDRM was created in 2005, and they basically set the standards and guidelines for anything dealing with ESI and eDiscovery. It's a helpful tool for understanding the eDiscovery lifecycle, which is what is referenced here in this graph. So the lifecycle begins with information governance on the left, and it goes all the way through to presentation. And in this presentation, I'm going to basically go through each of these steps in this framework and kind of provide a little brief overview of what each step deals with.
I'm sorry, Miss, what website were you referring to?
EDRM.net. Oh. And there's, I think in the last few slides, there's a link, there's like a resource page that has a link to that website, and also the Sedona Conference, which is another really, really critical website to look at. Similar thing, it's a group of judges, lawyers, vendors, that basically set the standards and guidelines for eDiscovery. So the first component in that framework was information governance. And what that is essentially the management of all information and records within an organization. And it's critical to have a handle of information governance as an attorney or as a paralegal, whoever's dealing with the client. You're required to know the client's computer usage policies, which are CUPs. Knowing these things will help guide the eDiscovery and ESI basically framework for each case. So the first first thing here is know the roles and responsibilities of company personnel as it relates to the CUP. The CUP basically helps you identify which executives or senior management personnel are charged with creating and implementing the CUPs, and which records officers and IT personnel are charged with designing and managing those policies. This will help you figure out who to go to when you're looking at ESI-related issues for an organization. The CUP should also help you identify where the electronically stored information is located. Again, once it comes time to figure out what data is out there, you're going to want to know where to go. Hopefully, the company has a CUP in place, which will help guide you in that process. The CUP will also provide information about how the employees are using and accessing the computer systems and the data and the devices. This is important because we want to know if, for example, a company has employees that are using their personal mobile devices versus a company mobile device. There can be implications either way. And finally, the CUP will help you determine what data retention policies are in place. So you're going to want to know whether the company has a data deletion policy that maybe is every year or every 5 years, and you'll want to put that practice to an end if litigation has begun. And on the subject of retention and distraction of ESI, it's okay for a company to have a systematic deletion protocol in place when there's no continuing need to retain it. It is not the same as evidence spoliation. So when there's no statutory, regulatory, contractual, business, or legal requirement to the contrary, routine deletion and recycling is okay. So the next step in the framework is identification. So one of the first things with identification is what we call early case assessment, or ECA. This is essentially what most of you are probably used to doing anyways. It's identifying the facts of your case, who are the key custodians, what departments are involved in that particular case, what are the significant dates and date ranges for that case, and what are the keywords that are important for that case. The next item is case merit and risk analysis. So a proper cost-benefit analysis is critical to effective early case assessment. And case value, another important thing, which I'm sure you all partake in when a case comes in. These three things kind of lead to this last component, which is case strategy. So once you understand the facts, the case merit, case value, you can then develop the strategy of your case and figure out what strengths and weaknesses exist, the major issues, and any aspects of the case that you need to develop. So from this early case assessment, the ESI component that comes into play is called early data assessment, which is EDA. And this is basically what is relevant ESI, where does it exist, who has possession of it, and where exactly is the ESI located. In order to figure these things out, you need to talk to the company's records management personnel. These are the people that really have control of the data, and they're going to be able to guide you in the right direction as far as what potentially relevant ESI exists and how to get it. Another gold mine of information for early data assessment are custodial interviews. So custodians are essentially those individuals, basically a fact witness in your case, people that either have information that relates specifically to the case, or they might know other people within the company that have information related to your case. So you're going to want to talk to these people and interview them and figure out exactly what they know about where potentially relevant information is, how to access it, and if they know of anyone who has potentially relevant ESI housed on any number of devices. And the last kind of group of individuals you're going to want to talk to are the IT personnel. Again, similar to the records management personnel, these are the people that really understand the systems that are utilized by the organization, email systems that are used, servers and how they operate, and whether or not employees have the ability to store electronic data on company devices and things of that sort. Again, they're going to really help guide you and figure out where the ESI is and how to get it. So, now that you've kind of been able to hopefully identify where all of the relevant ESI potentially is, you're going to want to make sure that that process has been documented so that it's defensible. So in the cases that we've done in our office, I found that it's usually helpful to obtain these specific documents from the organization that you're working with. Hopefully they have a records retention policy and schedule. If they do, definitely get that and hold it in your file. Any type of eDiscovery response plan. A few years ago, you would go to a company and it would be probably common that they wouldn't have something like this, but as the years go by, companies are becoming increasingly savvy and sophisticated when it comes to eDiscovery. They have their own eDiscovery teams in place, and so outside of just going to those people and talking to those people, you're going to want to obtain their eDiscovery response plan. Computer system lists, maps, and diagrams, those things are also helpful to obtain and keep. If at some point later in litigation someone questions, oh, well, where did you get this data from? You can point to that particular map or diagram of the company's data system and identify where you got it and how you got it. IT policies that may impact discovery. Again, some organizations now have social media policies that can come into play and be helpful. And organization charts. These can be helpful if, for example, certain executives leave a company, you have this chart, it's easier to identify exactly what position they held and when they held it. And then in addition to obtaining keeping items from the client or the organization, there are certain documents that you're going to want to create internally and keep within your files as part of this defensible documentation strategy. So there's no set template or anything for any of this stuff, but I'm sure if you ran some searches online, you could probably find things that are helpful. But any type of Excel spreadsheet or Word document that you create that has some kind of identification strategy or plan for how you collected the ESI, who you spoke to, the custodians, interview questions, responses, summaries that you prepared of those interviews, any surveys or questionnaires that you had, that you ask the IT people about. Again, interview logs, it's helpful to log exactly who you spoke to, when you spoke to them, what their title was at that time, things of that nature. Can always be helpful later on in litigation.
And can I just put a note down for a second if you want to go back to this? For solo or small or mid-sized firms, with the exception of the latter, which is really considered attorney-client privilege, or work product information. That first part is something that you as a smaller firm can use to do document requests against an adverse party also. So you can try to get your mitts on that stuff. That if you represent a company, you should make sure that they have all these things. But if you're suing a company or on the other side of a company representing the little guy or the little gal, these are the things that you can try to see if you can find some really good information from and make it part of your discovery requests.
That's exactly right. And one example of how that could be really helpful is, for example, say you're working with opposing counsel and they say, oh, we don't have those emails. We have a data retention policy of 1 year. But you obtain their records retention policy through discovery and it shows that their policy was actually 5 years. That could potentially be grounds for sanctions or some other negative later on in litigation.
Is it better to advise, if your client is a company, to advise them to have a lesser retention policy than a greater one? Or
it really depends. I found that the standard policies are typically 5 years, but like for example, some startups, they do 1 year just because they have much smaller databases and server capabilities.
Right.
So it really just depends. The important thing to note is whether it's 1 year or 5 years, it just needs to be something that's consistent, and you don't want it to look like, oh, all of a sudden now that litigation started, they have this policy of 1 year and they're starting to delete things.
Right. It's a 2-day policy now. So.
Yeah. Just be consistent, make sure people know it's this and not that.
Yeah.
Okay.
But it's a really nice way to equal the playing field when you're a smaller firm and the other side is a big company or a big firm, because you can start really digging and seeing what they have and what they don't have.
So having discussed identification, Now you need to actually figure out how to preserve the data. So once the relevant ESI has been identified, the duty to preserve is triggered, and that duty to preserve is triggered when litigation is anticipated. As I mentioned earlier, the Sedona Conference, it's an eDiscovery think tank, they've set forth some general factors to consider when determining whether that litigation has been triggered. Some of the things to consider when trying to determine whether litigation has been triggered is whether the known facts suggest that litigation is likely, whether consumer or customer complaints have been received that clearly and incredibly threaten suit, whether there have been repeated specific complaints about a particular issue, whether legal counsel anticipates a lawsuit or investigation, or whether company representatives know of the possibility of a lawsuit. On those last two components, sometimes it can be the case where there's some rumblings within media or even discussions between organizations about, oh, we think you're infringing on our patents. That might cue people to think, okay, there's possibly litigation that's coming, so we should really try and preserve anything that's relevant to that particular issue. Preservation of a client's data can be really cumbersome given the rise in ESI, and so there are ways to reduce the costs and burdens associated with the preservation of data. California and the federal rules have meet and confer requirements as it relates to ESI. In California, Rule 3.724 states that no later than 30 calendar days before the initial CMC, the parties must meet and confer to consider, among other things, the preservation of discoverable ESI, the form or forms in which that ESI will be produced, the time within which it will be produced, the scope of the discovery of the information, the methods for asserting or preserving claims of privilege or attorney work product, and the list goes on if you look at that rule. Again, with the FRCP Rule 26F, the parties are required to meet and confer as soon as practicable, but in any event, at least 21 days before a scheduling conference. And again, they're required to develop a discovery plan and state the views and proposals on any issues relating to ESI. This meet and confer component is becoming increasingly important. Courts are really, really honing in on this concept of cooperation between parties. So the more that you can cooperate and document that cooperation early on in the process, the better that you'll look in front of a judge if a discovery issue comes up later on. And it's also, again, a really good way of reducing the costs and burdens associated with ESI. So the legal hold is a component of preservation, and it's a process where an organization preserves all forms of relevant information. And any custodian that has potentially relevant information must receive this legal hold notice, and they actually have to agree to its terms. So they do have to sign off on it, acknowledging that they received it. Notification and subsequent reminders should definitely be created and distributed to those custodians. And again, you need to require the custodian to confirm receipt of that notification. Once there's no longer a continuing duty to preserve, the legal hold notice can be removed. So this is kind of a recap of the steps for preserving ESI. Depending on the number of custodians who have preservation duties, you might want to utilize an eDiscovery vendor. They sometimes have workflows and tracking tools that are really beneficial. For example, if you have like 30 plus custodians, it could become really cumbersome to track them all and see which ones have relevant ESI, whether they've accepted the hold notice, if they're still under that legal hold notice. These workflows have been designed to address those issues and to really make this process much easier for practitioners.
Do you just serve the legal hold notice onto the company, or?
Yeah, so typically it's just a letter that goes out. If it's an organization, it can go to the head of the company or the lawyers representing the organization. And you essentially just let them know that they have a duty to preserve, and you lay out kind of the categories of information that they're required to preserve based on what you know about the case, things that you think are potentially relevant, the issues and whatnot. some legal hold notices can be pretty detailed, but really, as long as you get the point across that these are the particular things that you need to preserve, that should do it. Again, there are templates out there that are available, I think both on EDR and .NET, as well as the CWL conference website. They're available for everyone to use. Just fill out a little bit of information about yourself, and you can access it and download it for your records.
Great. We don't usually serve, at least in my firm, we don't serve the legal hold notices, but what we do is it's good practice to send it by signature required.
Right.
Because then they can't say, well, we never received
right.
it. So don't request mail it. I would.
Right. Yeah.
So, something that's verifiable.
Okay.
Mail it.
Great.
So in this process of preservation, proportionality is a huge component. And again, this is something that judges are really taking a look at. You want to make sure that you're weighing the burdens and costs of preserving the potentially relevant ESI against the value and uniqueness of the information. So you'll want to consider whether it's cost effective to preserve ESI for custodians where there's maybe five other custodians who have that same information. You're not going to want to collect it from all five of those people if collecting it from one is enough. Also consider whether the information that you're looking at for that particular custodian is actually any different from the information that another custodian might have. Preservation should be effectuated in the most convenient and least burdensome way. So try and take a one-shot approach initially and try and minimize disruption to employees and operating systems. When you're dealing with organizations, it's pretty hard to gain access to their systems and whatnot. So it's also a good idea to get the records retention individuals and the IT personnel, use the company's resources to help you effectuate some of these tasks. So a seminal case as it relates to retention programs are and legal hold notices is the Zubilacki case. And the Zubilacki duty is you must understand your client's retention program and information management systems. Check back with key players who were hold notice recipients. Discuss the client's backup regime and communicate with the client on a consistent basis to ensure that all potential sources of relevant ESI are parsed up. The duty to preserve is ongoing as it relates to a client's ESI, so that's one important thing to remember. So now that we've kind of honed in on the potentially relevant ESI that we want to preserve, we actually are going to move on to collecting it. So proper collections are to be reasonable and made in good faith. And again, you should have an adequate chain of custody that helps document everything, make it defensible. The collection must also be based on a reasonable inquiry into the potentially relevant ESI. This reasonable inquiry is based on the early case assessment and the early data assessment that you conducted earlier on. So in some cases, it might be a financial burden to have a vendor go out and obtain the relevant ESI. So some people do self-collections. These are generally not advised because the person that's actually doing the collection might not appreciate the information that they need to actually preserve or collect. There's also the potential of altering the data and the metadata contained with the relevant ESI. And case law in recent years has actually started to question the process of self-collections due to the potential for impropriety or misunderstanding. So I guess it's kind of a tricky balance sometimes with an individual client. The costs can sometimes get a little bit high, but the good thing about that is as the years have gone by, the market's become increasingly saturated with vendors. So you can really, really work with your vendors, and I'll talk about this a little bit later, and get some of the costs down on some of these things. And hopefully it'll become more financially possible.
Then can you describe what self-collection is? Is it basically somebody going into their inbox and saving the entire inbox to like a separate hard drive or something?
Yeah, so it could be somebody going into their Gmail and looking for something related to the case, like any emails that you've sent to and from your wife, for example, in a family, in a divorce case. That might work sometimes, but it also might be that they missed a bunch of stuff. It's just not the some of that stuff isn't always obtainable. It could have been written over over time. So a self-collection, unless they're really, really sophisticated, they won't be able to retrieve any of that deleted data. A vendor will be able to retrieve it. So it's things like that that make self-collections kind of a practice that's losing its weight.
And there could also be clients who engage in some self-editing and self-help.
Oh, yeah.
They decide that something
should... None of us
should...
have clients like that, but...
We've never had possible. Clients like that, but, you know, if you ever have the misfortune, it's going to make everybody happy.
So when you're doing a collection, again, in this vein of defensibility, it's important to have a written collection protocol in place, and that protocol needs to include things like who is performing the collection. Again, hopefully it'll be an eDiscovery vendor, or if you're fortunate enough to have an eDiscovery unit within your firm, you can utilize those individuals. You'll also want to determine how the collection is being performed. Again, whose data is being collected, you're going to want to document that. Determine how the person's data is being collected, and then, again, document the collection protocol. So put it in some kind of writing, whether it's an Excel spreadsheet or a Word document. So as I mentioned earlier, the market is pretty saturated. You should definitely shop around for your vendor. And in doing so, you're going to want to consider certain things, like who your client is. Some vendors are larger than others, and they might not be as willing to negotiate on the price with you. Local vendors typically do, and I have a little resource list at the end of the slides that provides some of the vendors that we utilize on a regular basis, and I found that most of them are pretty willing to negotiate on prices for particular cases. And you're also going to want to consider what your client can afford, how much data is an issue, and importantly, what your eDiscovery timeline is. So some vendors are sometimes a little bit more responsive than others. We've had vendors that we've used that are based on the East Coast, and so sometimes having that 2 to 3 hour turnaround time can actually be a little bit, not an annoyance, but not as convenient. And then, as far as eDiscovery vendors are concerned, they are highly, highly sophisticated and savvy when it comes to this stuff. I was a paralegal at the firm for about 4.5 years before I started practicing, and I worked with my vendors on a daily basis on cases, and that's where I got all of my knowledge as it relates to eDiscovery. Well, not all of it, but most of it. They are more than willing to educate you and help you. Do not hesitate to ask them questions. Some firms, some practitioners actually have their eDiscovery vendors come with them to hearings if they need to address anything related to eDiscovery or ESI, whereas other firms just really use them for collections and review and processing. So again, it's on a case-by-case basis, but they are more often than not more than willing to jump in and help you on anything. So now that you've collected your data, it needs to be processed. The concept of processing is turning your collected ESI into a reviewable format. This task is best left to an eDiscovery vendor because they have superior knowledge of the systems and methods for ESI processing and the proper tools for the processing. And again, to ensure defensibility, you're going to want to adhere to the process auditing requirements of quality control, analysis, and validation, and chain of custody considerations. Those are all things that your eDiscovery vendor should be well versed in, and they should document it on a regular basis. So when you get to the processing stage, there is the concept of filtering and culling ESI. This will limit the amount of data that you actually have to review. So potentially relevant ESI is a much bigger balloon than the actual relevant ESI that you're going to have for your case. So filtering and culling helps limit, and the ways you can filter and cull is by date range. So for example, if your case involved an accident that happened in 2005, you're not going to really be concerned with any